Hello and thanks for tuning in. Phosphate has always been a hot topic with reef keepers. It's in our tap water, it's in our fish and invert food as well. Phosphate gets the blame for algae problems. Some say it even hurts our corals. When starting out, you'll find a lot of information about phosphates on the web. But don't worry, we'll break it down for you and tell you everything you need to know about phosphate and how to control it in your aquarium. Phosphorus is an essential element needed by all aquatic life. It's a building block for cellular energy, and it's a component of essential hormones and enzymes. Fish and invertebrates consume foods like plankton, algae, and meaty foods that are rich in phosphorus. These foods are organic sources of phosphate, which are then broken down in the gut for absorption by the organism. Excess phosphate is then excreted as waste in the form of inorganic phosphate, which is what you'll be testing for in your aquarium. Just about any organic substance can break down and release phosphate into your aquarium. Fish waste, coral slime, leftover food, detritus, and dead algae cells are all very common and natural sources of phosphorus in your aquarium. Your tap water is also another potential source of phosphate. Underground minerals leach phosphate into most water supplies. Water treatment plants also add phosphate to protect pipes against corrosion. This is one of the major reasons we really stress the importance of an RODI system at home. An RODI system will remove harmful impurities, including phosphate, so you can be sure your source water is clean and free of contaminants. Just like nitrate, phosphate will build up in the aquarium water if left unchecked. But the good news is that phosphate is not toxic and won't directly harm anything in your tank. Scientific studies of reef rock and corals reveal some interesting facts about phosphate. Here's what we know so far. Phosphate is one of the 17 essential elements that algae need to flourish. The general thought in aquariums is that phosphates fuel nuisance algae growth. Time and time again, we have witnessed nuisance algae problems being resolved by simply reducing phosphates to a point in which algae growth is limited. On the other side, there are documented accounts of thriving reef tanks that consistently test with phosphate levels above the recommended range. The likely reason here is that in these reef tanks, phosphate is not the limiting growth factor for algae. Instead, the algae is being limited by a lack of some other essential element. The effect of phosphates on coral growth is also something that is important to understand when keeping a reef tank. The science suggests that phosphate is not directly toxic to coral, but when phosphates are kept at higher concentrations, it can have some negative effects on coral. Symbiotic zooxanthellae within corals are stimulated by phosphate, providing more energy for tissue growth. If phosphates are high for long periods of time, the zooxanthellae can overpopulate and turn the coral brown. Science has also documented that the density of a stony coral skeletal mass is reduced when phosphate is kept at levels above 0.05 parts per million. The belief is that phosphate inhibits the calcification process. In conclusion, we can deduce that phosphate is essential for your reef tank, but should be kept at very low levels in order to avoid problems. Naturally, the next question is, what is the ideal range for phosphates in a reef tank? You'll find recommendations ranging from 0.02 all the way to 0.05 parts per million. But we've all seen real life reef tanks thriving at levels much higher than this at 0.1 parts per million or more. So the real answer is, it just depends. Every tank is different. I know you hate that answer, but let me explain. If your corals are consistently growing and nuisance algae is under control, the phosphate level is okay for your aquarium. If you've got algae problems, lower the phosphates and see how the tank responds. The idea is to bring the level down to where algae growth is inhibited, then maintain phosphate at that level. The most convenient way to keep track of phosphate is with an aquarium test kit that measures the inorganic phosphate level of our tank water. Not all test kits are created equal, so be sure to check out the range, resolution, and accuracy of the phosphate test kit you choose. This will ensure that the test kit gives you the readings you're looking for. The Hanna Instruments phosphate checkers are an excellent choice, and here at Marine Depot, we stock two different models to accommodate different situations. The standard low-range phosphate checker was designed for soft corals and fish-only aquariums and can measure phosphate levels from 0 to 2.5 parts per million with an accuracy of plus or minus 0.04 parts per million. Then we have the ultra low range phosphate checker, which was designed to provide more precision readings within the lower range. That is typical for mixed reef tanks and SBS aquariums. The ultra low range, or ULR, will measure from 0 to 0.9 parts per million with an accuracy of plus or minus 0.02 parts per million. Another option for testing is using one of the very popular mail-in or ICP water testing services that offer a phosphate or phosphorus test. A downside with all of these mail-in services is that it takes much more time to get the results compared to testing at home. Mail-in services are also more expensive, but the upside is that they're very accurate and will provide a full analysis of your aquarium water. I like to keep a few of these mail-in water test kits on hand at all times. This way, if I start to lose faith in any of my home test kits, I can easily double check using an ICP analysis or similar water testing service. In order to control phosphates in a reef tank, we aquarists have a variety of effective methods. We'd recommend employing a combination of methods. Generally speaking, we will not be able to rely on water changes alone. The reason we can't rely on water changes alone is that phosphate enters your aquarium at a much faster rate than which regular water changes can remove it. Even a weekly 20% water change will not suffice in keeping phosphates below 0.05 parts per million for a majority of reef tanks that contain fish. Using a good protein skimmer will strip out organics before they can release phosphate into the water. An efficient skimmer will remove dissolved and particulate organic matter. This will improve water quality and also limit phosphates and nitrates. An algae scrubber or refugium with macroalgae are both excellent options for phosphate control as well. A refugium with macroalgae will remove phosphate, nitrate, and other nutrients via the fast-growing macroalgae. Catomorpha is the most popular and safest species of macroalgae, but Caulerpa and Gracilaria are also very popular options. Macroalgae grows very fast, so you can easily find other local hobbyists who are willing to share. Join your local reef club or hop on one of your favorite online forums such as Reef to Reef to meet other hobbyists in your area. Algae scrubbers work on a similar principle, but instead of macroalgae, you're growing turf or microalgae on a screen. Tank water flows over an illuminated screen that holds the turf algae. Just like a refugium with macroalgae, harvesting the turf algae from your scrubber is very important. This physically removes the absorbed phosphates and keeps the algae growing aggressively. There are a variety of phosphate-removing filter media that work well in reef aquariums. The most popular is granular ferric oxide, or GFO for short. GFO binds inorganic phosphate as water flows through the media. GFO is also available in a wide variety of different brands. It works slowly when compared to other medias and is best used inside a fluidized media reactor to maximize the media exposure. Seachem Phosguard is another option. Phosguard employs fast-acting alumina oxide to absorb phosphates. Alumina oxide is fast-acting and is best used passively inside a media bag or canister filter. Blue Life USA just released PhosFX, which is a new resin-based phosphate removal media. It's getting excellent reviews online because it can be regenerated and used over and over again. It is fast-acting and is best used inside a media bag. If using a media reactor, just be sure the media is enclosed in a media bag so as to not spread the tiny resin beads throughout your whole tank. Lanthanum chloride is another option, and it comes in the form of a liquid which is dosed directly into your tank. The lanthanum binds with phosphate, forming microscopic insoluble lanthanum phosphate particles. The inert particles then are removed via mechanical filtration and protein skimming. Lanthanum chloride causes a little cloudiness but works instantly. You will need to change out your filter socks and empty your skimmer cup a few times during the treatment to be most effective. A clever and unique approach used by public aquariums is using GFO media alongside lanthanum chloride. The lanthanum chloride liquid can be used to drop your initially high levels of phosphate to an acceptable range. The GFO then can be employed to keep it within this range. This brings up a good point about phosphate control in general. A drastic drop in phosphates will really stress out your corals and invertebrates. An aquarium that is already accustomed to high levels of phosphates is especially sensitive, so be sure to test your water carefully and drop your phosphate levels slowly over time. In situations where both elevated nitrate and phosphates are a problem, you might consider using something that is designed to target both. A product like Red Sea's No-Pox Algae Management Supplement works by stimulating bacteria to consume phosphates and nitrates. The bacteria, now packed with phosphates and nitrates, are removed from the water through protein skimming. Choosing the right phosphate control method should be aimed specifically at your tank's needs. The first priority for everyone is to limit the input of phosphate to begin with. get an RLDI unit and only use phosphate-free water for top-off and water changes. Don't overfeed your tank and be sure to turn off your pumps when feeding. Use a quality protein skimmer at all times to remove organics before they break down into phosphate. If you have the space, add a natural filter like a refugium or turf algae scrubber. When phosphate levels are continually problematic, only then would I recommend the regular use of a filter media like GFO or a liquid remover containing lanthanum chloride. In this case, I will also recommend you reduce your stocking levels or improve your filtration system to help maintain a more acceptable level of phosphate long term. Relying on chemicals or media at all times can be a slippery slope and will get expensive. The main point to understand about phosphate control is that you should not be chasing a number, rather a clean and healthy reef. When your tank surfaces and rocks are clean and algae free, your phosphate level is likely safe and should only be monitored alongside all of your other major water parameters. If you start to see nuisance algae growing in your tank or notice your corals are just not looking their best, start testing your phosphate levels more often. If you notice rising or elevated levels above 0.05 parts per million, you should then begin working on removing phosphate and establishing a system to maintain it at a lower level. If you have questions about phosphate control or simply want to talk tank, give us a call or send us an email anytime. I appreciate all of you for watching today. Until next time, take care and happy reef keeping.